Hello friends and welcome back to the channel. Did you know that one of the world's most popular aquarium fish has an incredible history and fascinating biology? Meet the guppy, a tiny, colorful fish that has taken over freshwater habitats worldwide. In this documentary, we'll explore their origins in South America, their surprising role in mosquito control, and the science behind their dazzling colors. Plus, we'll dive into their unique life cycle, sexual dimorphism, and how they've adapted to different environments all around the world. Stick around as we uncover the secrets of the guppy, what makes them one of nature's most remarkable survivors. Stay tuned until the end of the video to find out why guppies are so colorful. The guppy is one of the world's most widely distributed tropical fish and one of the most popular freshwater aquarium fish species on the planet. It is a member of the family Poecilidae, and, like almost all American members of this family, it's a life bearer, such as mollies, platies, and swordtails. Guppies originate from the northeast of South America, but have been introduced to many environments and are now found all over the world. They are highly adaptable and thrive in many different environmental and ecological conditions. Male guppies, which are smaller than females, have ornamental caudal and dorsal fins. A dorsal fin refers to the fin on a fish's back, and a caudal fin refers to its tail fin. Wild guppies generally feed on a variety of food sources, including benthic algae and aquatic insect larvae, such as mosquito larvae. By the way, benthic comes from the Greek word for benthos, which is the community of organisms that live on, in, or near the bottom of a sea, river, lake, or stream. And guppies usually eat those benthic organisms and especially benthic algae. Guppies are often used as model organisms in the fields of ecology, evolution, and behavioral studies because they reproduce very fast and are very colorful. Guppies were first described in Venezuela as Poecilia reticulata by Wilhelm Peters, who was a curator of the Berlin Zoological Museum in 1859, and as Libistes poceloides in Barbados by Filippo de Filippi in 1861. So they were discovered or described twice in almost the same time. The guppy was then named Girardinus guppy by Albert Günther in honor of Robert John Latchmore Guppy, who sent specimens of the species from Trinidad to the Natural History Museum in London. So the guppy actually has its name from a man called Guppy, which is quite hilarious, I think. It was reclassified as Libistes reticulatus by Charles Tate Regan, a British ichthyologist, which means fish scientist, in 1913. Then, in 1963, Rosen and Bailey brought it back to its original name, Poecilia reticulata. While the taxonomy of the guppy was frequently changed and resulted in many synonyms, guppy remains the common name, even as Girardus guppy is now considered a junior synonym of the Poecilia reticulata name. And in the phylogenetic tree here, you can see many members of the Poecilidae family, which is an absolutely beautiful family of fish, in my opinion. And the guppies can be found almost on the bottom here, with the two species, Poecilia reticulata and Poecilia wingae, which is the common guppy and the endless guppy. If we look at their distribution and habitat, we can see that guppies are native to Antigua and Barbuda, Barbados, Brazil, Guyana, Trinidad and Tobago, and Venezuela. However, guppies have been introduced to many different countries and every continent except Antarctica. Sometimes this has occurred accidentally, but most often as a means of mosquito control. The guppies were expected to eat the mosquito larvae and help slow the spread of malaria. But in many cases, these guppies have had a negative impact on native fish populations, and therefore a negative impact on the mosquito population. Field studies reveal that guppies have colonized almost every freshwater body accessible to them in their natural ranges, especially in the streams located near the coastal fringes of mainland South America. And although they are not typically found there, guppies have also tolerance to brackish water. Brackish water is the mix of fresh and salt water, by the way, and have colonized some brackish environments. They tend to be more abundant in smaller streams and pools than in large, deep, or fast-flowing rivers. They also are capable of being acclimated to full salt water like their molly cousins. And this is something that I learned in one of my favorite YouTube channels. So shout out to this man here who does amazing jobs, who does an amazing job with his YouTube channel, which brought me to this finding. Guppies exhibit sexual dimorphism. While wild-type females are gray in body color, males have splashes, spots, or stripes that can be a wide variety of colors. The development and exhibiting of color patterns in male guppies is usually due to the amount of thyroid hormone that they contain. The sizes of guppies vary, but males are typically smaller, with 1.5 to 4 centimeters or 0.6 to 1.6 inches long, while females are 3 to 7 centimeters or 1.2 to 2.8 inches long. A variety of fancy guppy strains are produced by breeders through selective breeding, characterized by different colors, patterns, shapes, and size of fins, such as the snakeskin and grass varieties. Many domestic strains have morphological traits that are very distinct from the wild-type guppy. Males and females of many domestic strains usually have larger body size and are much more lavishly ornamented than their wild-type fish. These fish would probably not even survive in the wild because they are so colorful and slow swimming that they would probably be easy prey for any predator. Let's talk about the life cycle of guppies. 2 generations of guppies per year occur in the wild. Guppies are well developed and capable of independent existence without further parental care by the time they are born. Young guppies school together and perform anti-predator techniques. The brood size is extremely variable, yet some consistent differences exist among populations depending on the predation level and other factors. Females of matching body sizes tend to produce more numerous but smaller sized offspring in high predation conditions. Female guppies first produce offspring at around 10 to 20 weeks of age, and they continue to reproduce until 20 to 34 months of age. At the same time, male guppies mature in just 7 weeks or less, and the total lifespan of guppies in the wild varies greatly, but it is typically around 2 years. Variations in such life historic characteristics of guppies are observed in different populations, indicating that different evolutionary pressures exist. Guppies' body sizes are positively correlated with their age, and their size and maturation varies highly depending on the predation risk of the occupied environments. Male and female guppies from high predation regions mature faster and start reproducing earlier, and they devote more resources to reproduction than those from low predation regions. Female guppies from high predation regions reproduce more frequently and produce more offspring. Female guppies' reproductive success is also related to their age. Older females produce offspring with reduced size and at increased interbrood intervals. Population regulations. Resource availability and density also matter in regulation of guppy populations. Guppies reduce their fecundity, which is their ability to produce offspring, and reproductive allocation in response to scarce food. That means when they have less food, they reproduce less. When food is abundant, they increase their brood size. Differential reproductive allocation can be the cause of seasonality of life history characteristics in some guppy populations. For example, during the wet season from May to December, guppies from the northern range of Trinidad reduce their investment in reproduction regardless of the predation level, possibly in response to decreased food resources. Thanks for watching and learning about the amazing guppy fish. If you're excited to dive deeper into creating an incredible aquatic world, check out my next video, the 100 Species Ecosystem Aquarium. I'll walk you through the entire process of setting up a massive, thriving ecosystem tank, complete with guppies, nereids, plants, and more. Don't miss it. Click right here, right now, to start building your own underwater paradise. See you in the next video.